be at the alternate, just on the opposite side, and then the kid does the stuff for you.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I think it'll be like that is five on here, like the rich. But I can just grab the music stand.
I can do that since you're a horse.
Were you planning on saying anything for a while?
Yeah, I can say so.
Okay.
Good evening. It is great to see you all tonight. We're doing something a little different tonight. I was in Kansas last Sunday, so I asked Paul and Nettie to put together the music for last Sunday evening. And so they put together a great set list and got it all ready, and then we had to cancel service due to ice. So I'm going to invite Paul to come up, and he's going to lead us tonight. I'm going to try my hand at singing bass, so we'll see how that goes, but let's just worship together this evening. Oh, I do need to announce our elections and annual meetings. Terry reminded me because we didn't announce it last Sunday. I don't have to give any details, but just know that this month we will be having annual meetings and elections. So we have done our due diligence to inform the entire congregation, so now everybody knows that's a member of the church. All right, let's worship together.
Well, last Sunday we were still pretty close to Christmas, so we had selected O Come All Ye Faithful to begin. Number 175, it'll be on the screen, and sing together with me verses 1 and 2. If you want to sing from your hymnal, it'll be on the board, but there's something about the name. You know, we often during the Christmas season talk about Jesus is the reason. Well, let's sing about the name of Jesus.
Something about that name.
Jesus, the mere mention of his name can calm the storm, heal the broken, raise the dead. At the name of Jesus, I've seen sin-hardened men melted, derelicts transformed, the lights of hope put into the eyes of a hopeless child. At the name of Jesus, hatred and bitterness turn to love and forgiveness. Arguments cease. I've heard a mother softly breathe his name at the bedside of a child delirious from fever. And I've watched the little body grow quiet and the fevered brow cool. I've sat beside a dying saint, her body racked with pain, who in those fleeting seconds summons her last ounce of ebbing strength to breathe her sweetest name, Jesus. Jesus. Emperors have tried to destroy it. Philosophies have tried to stamp it out. Tyrants have tried to wash it from the face of the earth with the very blood of those who claimed it. Yet still, it stands. And there shall be that final day when every voice that has ever uttered a sound, every voice of Adam's race shall rise in one great mighty chorus to proclaim the name of Jesus. For in that day, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So you see, it was not mere chance that caused the angel one night long ago to say to the virgin maiden, his name shall be called Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You know, there is something about that name. From the hymnal, it's number 349, and we're singing He Keeps Me Singing, 349.
There's within my heart a melody, Jesus Christ.
praise team that I've had helping me. That's a new experience for me.
Yeah, I think I'm going to stick to singing melody, man. All right. Kids, at this time, you're invited to come down and sit on this first pew right here. We're going to switch it up so that we can use the camera up there. So get on this first pew, not on the steps, on the first pew here. That's right. Sorry for switching it on you.
All right, Jada's going to help us out with Sermon in the Sack tonight, and she's got a couple of things on her sack to help us tell a Bible story. Do you guys know what it is? Okay, so you're not going to guess, right? Oh, good job. All right, so first thing we have.
People.
Is a story in the Bible? Yeah, there's a lot of stories in the Bible about people. So think of one that you can think of. Is it supposed to be a guy and a girl? Okay, Amy? Adam and Eve? Oh, awesome. Good job. You must be reading about. Well, good thing to start in Genesis, right? And read all the way through. All right, what else do you have in there? So we got Adam and Eve up here. They look really good, don't they? They're well dressed. We've got some animals and bugs and birds and fish and mammals. Did you cut all these out and put them on the paper? Oh, Brooklyn helped you. Oh, that's a good sister. And, oh, good. We got a tree with fruit on it. You want to tell us? You have more? Okay. You want to start telling the story? You want to pull everything out? You want to pull everything out? Oh, goodness. That's a fake one, right? All right. I'm making sure. I'm going to give Pastor Kim a heart attack here. Okay. You can sit on that side. What is that? A snake. And, all right, we've got an apple there. Well, tell us a little bit about Adam and Eve.
God said you can eat from every tree except one, and it was called the apple tree, and Eve was going to that tree, and the snake said, if you eat from this tree, then you'll be like God, and she ate it, and then God said, no, don't eat it, you'll die, and she ate it.
Okay. So, first off, she wasn't staying away from temptation, was she? Because she was over there by the tree. Is that the way life is sometimes? The closer you get to temptation, the more likely you are to give in. So she was over there by the tree that God had said to stay away from. And she started listening to the advice of the wrong friend. And it wasn't a friend at all, was it? And he told her to go ahead and take some fruit off that tree. And what did she? After she ate it, then what happened? She knew she did the wrong thing, didn't she?
Yeah.
So did she go tell God she was sorry? Or did she run and hide, or did she share it with someone else?
She shared it with someone else.
Yeah, is that like us sometimes when we get in trouble, then we want someone else to get in trouble too, so it's not just us. And we go, well, but he did it. Our brother did it, or sister did it. Instead of saying, I did the wrong thing and saying that we're sorry. Yeah, that's what Eve did. She knew she did the wrong thing from eating from the tree. And so instead of confessing and telling God she was sorry, she got Adam to eat some too. But did he have the choice to say yes or no? And what did he do? He said yes. So it was just as much his fault too, wasn't it, for making the wrong choice? So they both did, and then what happened?
Then they hide it.
Yeah, does that happen? Sometimes when we make a bad choice, we go, oh, I'm going to get caught. I'm going to go hide. What happens? Are you usually able to hide from mom and dad or from grandma and grandpa or whoever it is you did the wrong thing against? Are you able to hide forever or do you usually get found?
I usually get.
Yeah, or even if you don't hide and you try to hide what it is you did wrong, if you break a toy and you try to hide it, does your sins come out? Do people find out about it? Yep, and the same thing happened with Adam and Eve. God already knew, but he found them in the garden, and then what happened?
Then she told God that she was sorry.
Yeah, and she tried to, Adam tried to blame Eve, and Eve tried to blame the serpent, and they had to be accountable for the things that they did wrong, didn't they? And then there was a consequence. They had to leave the garden, and life became a lot harder for them. Well, boys and girls, what can we learn from this story? Okay, Mia?
That Adam and Eve shouldn't be eating from the fruit that they should have been.
They should have been doing the wrong thing. Exactly, Amy? Yeah, stay far away from it. Okay, Brooklyn?
They feel like it's wrong, but
right, because if you're close to it, you start thinking about it, it's going to be easier to do that. Just keep your thoughts on something else. Okay. Anybody else? Nope. All right, well, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. And pray with me. Dear Jesus, help us to be strong and stay far away from temptation. And Lord, we pray that you'll help us to know what is right and what is wrong, and give us the strength to choose the right choice. And if we make the wrong choice, we pray that you'll give us the courage to say we're sorry and turn from our sin. In your name, amen. Good job.
An opportunity this evening to give back to the Lord out of his many blessings to us, and to share together any ways that we can pray for one another. So anyone have any praises or prayer requests you'd like to share with the body? The team is in the air. Our team that has been in Belize for the last 9 days are on their way back, so pray for their continued safe travels. Yes, Armstrong boys. All right, pray for Nana. Yes, Mark. All right, let's pray for Austin. He's got a sore throat. Yes, Brooklyn. Yep, pray for Miss Frankie and her family. She's at Grace Living Center now, I believe. Yes. Brother and sister both. All right, well, let's pray for Audrey's brother and sister. Evan, did you have one? Oh, okay, it's for Frankie. Pray for all the teachers and students and administration. I think most of them going back tomorrow, teachers at least tomorrow, students on Tuesday. Yeah. Pray for all the last-minute homework that will be happening. We've had 2 weeks to do. Well, we do want to give praise for the team of Belize and for their safety and for God's protection. I'm sure we'll hear some great stories when they get back. Pray for the people that still don't have electricity. Yep, and all the linemen and technicians. Yes, ma'am. Pray for Mr. Terry Dorvach's arm. Good. That's a great thing. Yes, Brooklyn. Whose eye? Aaron's eye. Pray for Aaron's. Oh, I thought he got a tattoo. I couldn't tell what that was. All right, well, ushers, come forward at this time, and let's lift each other up in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for this evening and for each person here. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to gather together as the body of Christ and to share with one another our burdens and our joys, our sorrows and our happiness, God. Let us pray that the requests that were mentioned here tonight, Lord, that you would keep them on our mind as we go throughout this week. May we be reminded of one another and make it a habit of praying for each other, Lord. Pray especially for the Belize team, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity that they had to do your work, to be your hands and feet around the world, for the protection that you gave them, and we just continue to pray for them as they are traveling back to us. But Lord, I just pray that you would take this offering tonight and that you would multiply it to do your work around the world. We love you tonight. Amen.
Tonight's going to be fun because I'm used to a pretty lively bunch on Sunday morning, so I'll expect that same energy and excitement from all of you, you know, and the wiggles and the fidgets and the snores. Oh, wait, they don't snore usually on Sunday mornings, so we'll hope that you guys don't fall asleep either. But thinking through the beginning of 2016 and just changes and different things going on in our lives, what are some things that you do out of habit or because it feels comfortable to you? So this is our discussion time. Some things that are comfortable to you or you do it out of habit. Brush your teeth. Okay, Evan? Sleep. Yeah, it's comfortable. All right. Mo, you had one?
Start a diet.
Start a diet, yeah. What are some other things that are comfortable or you do out of habit? I'm going to have to think about it. Come on, Nathan. I know you have one. Oh, Abby says, speak up less. Eat. Okay, Brooklyn. Climb trees. Yeah. Is that comfortable or just fun? Both. Okay. Okay, Jada. Hiking. Drink. Yeah. More flannel pajamas. Ah, so fun things like that. And I was trying to think, what's the difference between doing something that we enjoy doing and or so we have changes, things that are different. New Year's, lots of times you look at things that you can do differently. You know, you think, oh, well, in 2015 I did this, but 2016, you know, I'm going to start that diet or that exercise or those flannel pajamas or whatever it is that you want to do for 2016. And thinking about changes, what's different between a change and a variety? You know, because you think about it, you know, you might want to do the same thing every single day. I'll tell a story on my dad, and it's not a secret, but when I was growing up, his favorite lunch was peanut butter and jelly and an orange and 2 sandwich cookies. And every day from my at least 20-something years that I can remember, he would pack that every single day for lunch to work. And I would ask him, you know, periodically, you know, once every year or every couple years, you know, do you want to try a ham sandwich, grilled cheese sandwich, something else? Or what about an apple? No, this is good. You know, I like it. I said, well, you know, finally when I got older, teenager, like, why do you want to eat this? He's like, well, you know, I don't know. You know, I like it. I like peanut butter and jelly. I like cookies. I like my orange. You know, it's good. I kind of started to think about it. It's like, maybe it's just because he's comfortable with it. It was a habit. He did it every day. Something he was comfortable. He didn't want to change it. And then I started thinking about, well, maybe, you know, now that I'm looking back on it and as a parent, I'm thinking, well, that probably saved us a lot of money that he didn't eat out every day, but he took that same sandwich every day. But I don't know. I think more of it had to do with just being comfortable, and it was a habit. And so I think about variety. Well, for me, you know, I might eat that once or twice, but I want something different, you know. Even if that means I have to go try a new recipe or, you know, add flavor to something, I don't want to do the same. I have my things I like. If I go to the same restaurant, you know, I have that one or two dishes that I will order. But, you know, after a while, I want to do something different. If I were to go there every single day, I can guarantee you by day 3 or 4, we're going to try something new. And so I was thinking, what's the difference between change and variety? What do you guys think? Change and variety. Change, you usually think of, okay, Evan? Kind of permanent? Yeah. Okay. Change is kind of permanent. That's good. What else is different between change and a variety? Okay, Brooklyn? It's kind of hard, isn't it? I saw a grown-up hand back there. Someone? Okay, Nathan? Ooh, change, you give up something old, variety, you add something new. Okay? I think probably a lot of that goes along with that. You think of change, you think I have to change something, you know, change the laundry, change the dishes in the dishwasher. You kind of maybe associate something, you know, change my eating habits. You think of something negative, whereas a variety, you think of adding something, you know, creating a little bit different. Well, tonight, unfortunately, we're going to talk about change, you know, because that's the fun part. And I was thinking as we begin the year of 2016, there's a big possibility that it will hold some changes for all of us. You guys agree? In fact, there's probably at least 3 things we can expect with change. I'll tell you a story first I was going to end with, but I'll go ahead and tell you at the beginning, and then I'll explain those 3 things I was thinking about changes. I was reading a book over break by Spencer Johnson that tells the story of 2 mice. Their names were Sniff and Scurry, and 2 little people named Him and Haw that lived in a maze. Any of you guys read this book without telling the title? A lot of you in businesses probably have. Well, every day they'd leave their homes and they'd scurry down the corridors to find their food for the day. They'd go down this corridor and they'd look and there wouldn't be any food. They'd go down this other one and they would try out different corridors. And eventually they found this big room that held all this cheese. And it was this huge stash. And they decided, you know, as being smart mice and little people that they were going to go back there every day and get their daily supply of cheese. The mice would arrive early and check out the cheese supply, eat what they needed, and then leave. The little people would arrive a little bit later, and the next day would be a little bit later, and a little bit later. They were really comfortable with the routine and confident that cheese was always going to be there. Kind of us with our habits, you know, that peanut butter and jelly sandwich is always going to be in that box for the lunch box. We get comfortable with that cheese, and gradually they built their social life and homes around this cheese station, and it became a source of safety and a source of status. You know, people would come over, oh, look at my stash of cheese. We've got all different varieties here. Look at this. Isn't it good? One day the cheese disappeared. Uh-oh. The 2 mice, Sniff and Scurry, weren't completely surprised as they'd noticed the supplies of cheese gradually dwindling. To them, the problem and answer was simple. The situation had changed, and thus they needed to change. They set off to find new cheese, sniffing out the corridors, and Scurry hurrying ahead as fast as possible. Eventually, after a few days, they found a new supply of cheese. Not as big as the first stash, but enough for their needs. Him and Haw, however, were unprepared for this lack of cheese. They arrived much later in the day. When they got there, they were not very happy. In fact, they started yelling and screaming and going, "That's not fair! Where's our cheese?" And they talked about it, and they stayed there for a while, and guess what? No cheese appeared. Eventually, they left and went home hungry, kind of grumpy. And they came back the next day confident that their cheese was going to be there again. And they walked into that corridor, and guess what? No cheese. day after day, they would come back to that room and they analyze the situation, discuss what happened and who was to blame until they were hungry and weak and depressed. Eventually, when the mice didn't return, Ha decided that it was time to set out and look for some new cheese. Him, however, refused to leave, remaining in the empty, cheeseless corridor. As Ha journeyed out, he started to look at what had kept him in there so long and why he was so reluctant to leave to go look for new cheese, when obviously cheese wasn't going to appear. And he started to see the humor in his fear, laughing at himself and realizing what he'd been afraid of wasn't near as bad as what he'd imagined. He learned to enjoy the adventure and taste of delicious new cheese that he would never have tried had he stayed in that empty, cheeseless room. So thinking about this, it's kind of a funny little story about mice and people, and if we looked at ourselves, we probably could see ourselves in one of those characters. But there's three things we can expect with change. The first one is change is inevitable. It happens. You have changes in relationships, changes in your health, in your job, in your school, prices on food and gasoline. In Ecclesiastes 3:1-8, it says, there's a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, a time to uproot. A time to kill, a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. And there's something really constant in that passage. What word do you think would describe it? Change. I mean, if you're looking at it, we may or may not experience all those things, but there's a lot of changes listed in that passage. Some of us have seen a lot of that. We've seen people be born. We have some more coming. We see people die. We see people dance. We have a time of mourning. We have a time of laughter. Life is full of change. Reading through the scriptures, I was trying to decide what passage I wanted to use when I prepared my sermon. And I started a couple weeks ago, and I started reading and kept reading. And the good thing about the Bible is when you open it up and start reading, you kind of get involved in the stories of God. And it was really hard to decide. You know, I was trying to find a person that I wanted to talk about. And the more I started reading different passages in the Bible, I found one thing in common, and that was change. Each person in the Bible, you know, you look through the Bible heroes and even the people that weren't heroes, they had life-changing moments. Abraham left his family and his home to travel to a new land. He became the father of Isaac at, how old, kids? 100 years old. Talk about a big change. It's older than anyone here in the room becoming a parent for the, and that would be kind of pretty big change in your life. David went from protecting sheep to killing a giant from the Philistine army to later becoming king. Saul started off persecuting Christ followers to having a life-changing moment on the road to Damascus, changed his name to Paul, and became a missionary, and then repeated the cycle because then he became persecuted. Change happens even when you leave things the same. You think sometimes, oh, if people just leave my songs alone, or they just leave my, you know, my seat alone, or they leave my sandwich the way I made it, you know, things would be fine. But I was thinking about, even if you make homemade fresh bread, which this is not, but those of you that make homemade bread, I just had to clarify that just in case you looked at me and thought I was lying. But you make bread and you, especially the homemade variety, doesn't have all the preservatives in it, and you think if I just leave it alone, it'll be good. You know, I keep it in a little bag or a box to keep it fresh. And it doesn't take very long, usually 2 or 3 days, and it starts to get this green, fuzzy stuff on it, and it goes bad. So even things that are left alone change. Can't guarantee that if you preserve it just right, it'll stay the same. So the first thing is change is inevitable. The second thing that we should expect for the year of 2016 is that change happens often. I was reading, one of the other characters I was reading about in the Bible was Esther, one of my all-time favorites. And I was looking at her life and thinking, you know, she's been a Bible hero of mine since I was a little girl. And I thought, oh, it'd be so much fun to be Esther and be a queen. And I started reading more about her story and did a Bible study about her a while back. And her life wasn't quite as glamorous as we would think. And she started off an orphan, didn't have a mom and dad, was raised by a cousin, a male cousin at that. So as far as we know, no mother figure there in her home. And you know, kind of settles into this new home with her cousin taking care of her, cousin Mordecai. And then change happens again for her. As a young girl, she was taken with a bunch of other pretty young girls from her city to participate in a royal beauty pageant, where the prize is, get this, to get to marry an older king. Not exactly every young girl's dream to marry an old man and not even get to choose, but to have that chosen for you. She was given 12 months of beauty treatments before she would even see the king. Now, I don't know, but, you know, 12 months of facials and waxes and hair treatments and stuff doesn't exactly sound like a lot of fun. I mean, it's fun to do it for, like, a date night or a party or something like that, but to think that that's your whole purpose in life for a year, day in, day out, hour after hour, is to make yourself beautiful and more beautiful, seems not as much fun as it's cracked up to be. This Esther ended up marrying the king and becoming queen. So she went from orphan to niece to the palace. She had a lot of changes in her life. Sometimes it seems like when we adjust to a change or become comfortable, right, when we get to that comfortable stage, you know, not to get too comfortable, because that usually means another change is coming around the corner. As parents, I think about, you have those new precious little babies, and you have them, and they're born, and you want to capture every moment on picture, you know, with your camera. You start taking pictures, you know, the first time they smile, and the first time they coo, and the first time they do this, and the first time, word they say, you write it all down. And after a while, it's hard to keep up with all the words they're saying, especially if you have children that learn words really quickly. And you have this front and back page of all these words they're learning, and then, you know, you can't wait for them to get that first tooth, and then they bite you. Then you can't wait for them to crawl, and then you chase after them to change their diaper. Can't wait for them to walk and take that first step, and then before you know it, they're that precocious toddler running around the pews at church. It just goes faster and faster. Then become a kindergartner and a second grader and someday a teenager. And then before you know it, some of you guys can attest to this, that you become a grandparent, and you look in the mirror one day like, how did I become a grandma and grandpa? Last I knew, I was that 20, 30-year-old something chasing kids around the house. Time changes. And it happens fast. That's one thing we can see. So we know that change is inevitable and change happens often. But the most important thing is change prompts you to action. Looking back at the story of Esther, Mordecai became aware of a plot that was to assassinate the Jews and sent a message to Esther, warning her of this plot. She was finally adjusting to life as a queen and living in the palace. And now she has this dilemma. Her cousin comes to her and demands that she take a message to the king and tell him what is about to happen. He wasn't even aware of her nationality. She had kept that a secret. And even a bigger problem, she hadn't even seen the king for over 30 days. I mean, why would he want to see her now? I mean, no, you don't have the cell phone to pull out and call the king, hey, honey, are you ready to come see me? You want to go eat dinner? No, you had to wait till the king summoned you, or you had the risk of losing your life. And here she was pressured to take a message to the king. And she had a couple options. I mean, she'd go crawl back in bed and pull the covers over her head. I'm not going to do it. I'm scared. Some of us, that's a way of dealing with problems or change, is like just digging our heels and just flat out refuse to change. We're going to just keep things the way they are. Or maybe if we ignore it, it'll go away. It hasn't worked so well for me, but, you know, maybe it works a little bit better for you. But thinking about that, she had a couple options with that. She could ignore it, hide from it, stop it. But she called to her cousin. She sent a message to him, and her message said, go gather all the Jews who are in Susa.